Greetings and welcome to Vanderbilt University Medical Center and to the third annual Global Burden of Surgical Diseases Working Group workshop. My name is Doug Heinberger, and I am an associate director of the Vanderbilt Institute for Global Health, which is serving as your principal host here on the Vanderbilt campus. Very pleased to be here. I've met a number of you this evening or others prior to this, and I look forward to the next couple of days with you, getting to know hopefully all of you and finding real sparking of ideas and great cross-pollination, very creative thinking about the burden of surgical diseases and how really to make it, give it a higher place on the radar screen of global health. I'm going to be very brief tonight because we have a few other people to introduce, particularly Senator William Frist, who's going to speak to us as we're eating this evening. And he needs to leave, unfortunately, at least by 7 o'clock, I understand, in order to get on to an engagement out of town that will begin tomorrow morning. And I will say a little bit more about the Vanderbilt Institute for Global Health tomorrow morning as we get started with our deliberations there. Now just let me have the pleasure of introducing the Dean of the School of Medicine and the Vice Chancellor for Health Affairs of Vanderbilt University, Dr. Jeff Balzer. Dr. Balzer, as many of you know, is an anesthesiologist, in fact, so it's particularly fitting that he's here to greet you. Dr. Balzer, thank you.
Thank you, Doug. So on behalf of the Vanderbilt University and the School of Medicine, it's my pleasure to welcome all of you to this fabulous event, the third annual Burden of Surgical Disease annual meeting. It's hosted by the Institute for Global Health, and I want to say a little bit more about the Institute in a moment. I want to make sure we thank the Vanderbilt Department of Anesthesiology and the Vanderbilt International Anesthesiology Program. We want to thank the Department of Surgery and the Section for Surgical Sciences, who've also been helpful in sponsoring this event. And finally, but certainly not least, the important role the Vanderbilt University School of Nursing has played in supporting this activity. The Institute for Global Health was formed in 2005 with the move of Dr. Stenberg Vermont to Vanderbilt, and it began as a School of Medicine entity. And I don't think anyone could have imagined how quickly the Institute would blossom. And I like to think of it as an institute on steroids. It's now, and we've actually formally recognized the Institute as having university-wide status. Sort of like the Kennedy Center, it is in just about every school of the university. It's hard to think of a place at Vanderbilt University that the Institute is not supporting international activity, and it's very exciting that the Institute activities are both service and discovery, and I think that really exemplifies what Vanderbilt's all about, and we're bringing value not only to the educational enterprise here through its activities, but to many, many people in countries around the world. I think these recent earthquakes in Chile and Haiti are the really bring to the forefront what is important about universities in foreign countries, and that you can see, I think, as we've dealt with those tragedies, we not only have work to do around how we serve those countries, but we need to do some work around what we need to do to help them from the front end. So the mission of the Institute is not just, again, a service mission, it's a discovery mission. How can we be most effective in supporting international health? And I think that I'm biased, of course, being an anesthesiologist, but I think if you look at the experience in Haiti, perioperative and injury-related support is something that was desperately needed and didn't move quickly enough. And we need to understand how to, when the next catastrophe comes, how to make that better a whole lot quicker, and that's actually a research question. So I'm very excited about the role the Institute is playing at Vanderbilt and about the role it's playing throughout the world through its missions of education, research, and patient care. I want to acknowledge our keynote speaker, Bill Frist. Senator Frist is practically living out of a suitcase these days. He's all over the world, and by agreeing to be here to do this, he really honors us. And I'm very, very appreciative that he would do this tonight. I also want to thank Doug Heimberger. Doug has done a fabulous job as the Associate Director for the Institute putting this meeting together. And I know that you're going to have a fabulous 2 days during this meeting. And finally, I want to thank all of you who make up the Burden of Surgical Disease Working Group. And I'd like to welcome you to Vanderbilt from all the different places you've come. I'd like to now invite Kelly McQueen to the podium. Kelly is a fellow of the Harvard Humanitarian Initiative and Director of Graduate Medical Education for Valley Anesthesiology Consultants in Phoenix, Arizona. She's the driving force behind the Burden of Surgical Disease Working Group and is responsible for bringing us all here tonight, and she's an anesthesiologist.
Wait, just 1 minute. I have something.
Oh my. Thank you.
Well, thanks to all of you and welcome to Nashville. I know most of you in the audience, and I look forward to meeting those of you that I don't know. It's really a privilege to have so much support from the Vanderbilt community. It's been great for me to get to know Nashville a little bit in the last year and to spend time really in the last 6 months with the staff here and with all the amazing global health people that they have on campus. Along with Jeff, I'd like to thank the Vanderbilt Institute for Global Health, Vanderbilt Anesthesiology, and the Vanderbilt International Anesthesia Program, who obviously I align closely with. Also would like to thank the Sector for Surgical Services, the Vanderbilt Medical Alumni Association, who is incredibly helpful to us, and last but certainly not least, the Vanderbilt School of Nursing, where we'll all be meeting tomorrow. Our keynote speaker tonight, as already mentioned, is well known to all of you here from Tennessee, but his gifts for medical expertise, humanitarianism, and diplomacy make him well known even to a girl who lives in Arizona, and perhaps many of you who live all around the world. Senator Frist is a heart-lung transplant surgeon, a longtime humanitarian, and a two-term U.S. senator from Tennessee who also served as the Senate Majority Leader. He, in spite of all of his accomplishments, has made his ability, however, to be a wonderful human spirit and to always be available to those interested in his causes. When I was a fellow at the American Association for the Advancement of Science, I was introduced to Senator Frist by my state senator, and in spite of his busy schedule, he made time to spend about 10 minutes with me as an aspiring humanitarian as well. So it's really a pleasure to introduce you, Senator. Thank you so much for being here. It's an honor to have you speak to us, and we hope to learn a little bit about what you've been doing in Haiti tonight.
All right, everybody eat. Everybody eat. We're going to have fun tonight, and let me welcome all of you to Nashville. This is my home, although I have been on the road for the last 11 days, and I've got a 66-pound suitcase out there, paying $50 every time it goes over 50 pounds, that is my evidence. I did want to be with all of you and made the commitment as soon as I heard about your gathering here today to be here and to say yes. And it is for reasons that I hope will be sort of self-explanatory as I speak a little bit with you tonight. And again, for the servers, just I kind of want to keep it informal. I'm going to move pretty quick, and I've got slides and all coming through. My message, I think, will be pretty apparent. But to the servers, y'all just keep working. As people eat, just kind of keep bringing the food. Let me see. Where are we going? Nashville, Tennessee. I was going to say that I grew up here. I founded the heart and lung transplant program here. My dad practiced medicine here for 50 years. Both my brothers physicians. We have great medical centers here, Vanderbilt. Wayne Riley is here tonight, sitting at the table here, who runs Meharry Medical School. And you put those two schools together with the nursing school here, with the Institute, with our commitment to global health, you know, it is a rare, rare community. I will say on the outside of that, it's interesting as well in that Nashville is it's sort of the Silicon Valley of health services for the world. Over 300 healthcare companies have been founded right here. 17 are publicly held, $50 billion of revenues. There's no city, including New York, LA, Atlanta, or Dallas, who does more in health services than Nashville, Tennessee. There's some fun stuff as well. I do also want to introduce Jenny Dyer. Jenny, just raise your hand up. And Jenny and I do global health together. We're partners in my wife sometimes thinks we're married since I'm not here, but Jenny runs with me Hope Through Healing Hands. I'll refer to that, and we use health as a currency for peace. And I mention that because I have had the opportunity, even as majority leader, to spend a lot of time in the developing world doing medicine. And when you're doing medicine, whatever doing medicine is, whether it's public health or nursing or anesthesia or social work or clean water stuff, whatever it is, it brings trust, it brings understanding, and if there's fighting going on, it stops or it gets quieter, and it's really quite remarkable. And so in Washington, I began using this little mantra of using medicine and health as a currency for peace because I believe it, I see it. And we're going to come back and we talk about service, and service is obviously what we all do, whether it's through anesthesia or nursing or medical school or being a doctor, but how we expand that service to people we'll never see again who are faceless to many people who don't have the opportunity to go and serve is very much what we are all about. Nashville, Tennessee, real quickly, advertising. Grand Ole Opry, longest continuously running live radio program in the world, broadcast every Friday, Saturday night since 1925. While you're here, get out and play. Don't let Kelly sit there and drive you so hard that you don't get out and see what Nashville has to offer. The Goo Goo, many of you may not know what Goo Goos are, but if you're not from Nashville, you're not from Tennessee, and you don't watch the Grand Ole Opry, but you will before you leave. It is a Nashville delight. It's got all the stuff that Michelle Obama and her obesity effort, which, by the way, I'm going to be co-chair of, it hadn't been announced yet, would say, don't eat it. But it makes for a good logo out there with its caramel, marshmallow, milk, chocolate together for a cluster of candy. Tennessee earned the name Volunteer State. A lot of people don't know why. War of 1812, 100 more soldiers, when they asked for volunteers, left our state. Also, some people say it's because we founded Texas, the Alamo, Davy Crockett, Sam Houston, all those people out of Tennessee. This town here, it's interesting. The presidents that have come out of here, I have them listed here, Andrew Jackson, James Polk, and Andrew Johnson. Also, Vice President Gore lives about six blocks from me today. And so it's got an interesting tradition in terms of politics as well. I mentioned the healthcare companies, the investor-owned industry here, but as I said, over 300 companies right here in Nashville, Tennessee. Tennessee ties with Missouri in that we have eight states surrounded. Nobody has more, so we're great neighbors. So come back and come back frequently, and probably most importantly for many of you, Elvis Presley. Right here about six blocks from here, more than 200 of his songs were at the historic Studio B on Music Row, which you can all go to. That's why I came back to Nashville. I live in the same home that I was born in 58 years ago. So we like tradition, we like legacy, we like keeping those values around. We make a living by what we get, we make a life by what we give. All of us have our sort of sayings that we use to some way justify what we do or why we're interested in either medicine or healing or healthcare. But whatever it is, we know by putting the time in, by investing that time, we have an impact that makes us part of something much greater than ourselves. And some people do it in their local community, and that's what we do by being doctors. And some people say, well, there's something more that's out there. And that's where the whole sort of surgical disease arena is attraction to so many of us as we go overseas and as we serve in whatever capacity we choose to. Just a couple of shots I put in there just to remind me to say, because I'm going to come to the crisis end of things, is that for me, My world was opened up principally in Africa, although I've spent time in Bangladesh and other parts of the world doing medical work. Most of my work has been in 12 different countries in Africa. And before getting involved in crisis situations, there's a huge advantage, and I would say almost a necessary condition to having spent some period of time doing medical work in the developing world or low-income, low to low to mid-income world. This is in Kenya. That's my wife, Karen. I always take one of my boys with me wherever I go. If I go for a month, I still take one. If I go for 2 weeks, one. In Haiti, I didn't because that came up quickly. But in Sudan, Darfur, I've always had one person in my family with me, even as little boys. And as they've grown up, I have three boys. Spent a lot of time in the refugee camps. This is back in Otash, where many of you have been at different points in time. We don't know very much about the refugee population in terms of burden of surgical disease. A few publications, I had a student from Princeton who's now at Hopkins, actually, who I sent over for about 2 months. But this whole displacement with a million people now displaced right now in Haiti is an issue of what is the surgical disease and that burden in these itinerant populations who are mainly in tents today, but who in all likelihood are going to be moving sometime in the next 6 to 8 months. The backdrop, I'm going to have to speak personally. I'm not going to speak on them too much, but I did spend time after the Asian tsunami, about 5 days after that occurred. I was at the time Majority Leader of the United States Senate, and I left as Majority Leader, but left security behind and not in the cameras and all, but had the opportunity to be on the ground there. I'm going to mention tsunami and also Katrina itself. Katrina, the levees broke on Tuesday, and I had the chance to go in Friday. And I'll show you some images there. And I show you both of these very quickly as a backdrop because it's disaster, natural catastrophe. And I'm not going to be talking about man-made catastrophe, but those of you who are involved in 9/11, exactly the same sort of thing, although there was no surgical disease there. But I'm going to use these as a backdrop because they're very different from a surgical standpoint as to what we found in Haiti. The tsunami itself hit unexpectedly. It was the worst tsunami in recorded history. The numbers of lives lost, but look at the range at which it hit, was the same number that were lost in the Port-au-Prince area itself over about the same amount of time. So the size, the magnitude in terms of life lost, the degree of rehabilitation afterwards is totally different. As those of you, and I know many of you were in Haiti, in Haiti the other day, those first few days where we were doing just amputations. That's all we could do to save lives at the time before supplies came. It didn't occur in the tsunami itself. This picture itself I just took out of a helicopter in Sri Lanka, but it really captures the image that I want to portray for the tsunami itself. Because the tsunami hit, it hit quickly, and all those pictures that come back that you see really are accurate, but it only went about a quarter of a mile in, and then it stopped. So any of the infrastructure that was out there, which was a lot of the water infrastructure and clinics and facilities that weren't on the beach, were still standing. And therefore, after the insult itself, you had people hurt with the sort of injuries like this, that were bumps. If you didn't drown, you'd have these bumps and scrapes and a few broken bones, but not many. But then you had facilities to go through. You could get supplies in. Roads were still coming in. So very different than what we saw in Haiti. I mentioned service through government because a lot in the lessons learned is how you interact with government and especially our military on the ground. And I'll talk a little bit more about that, and you'll see in some video footage that the military is very, very important, especially where there's chaos and where there's indecision and where there's security risk to you when you're coming in. Service to the private sector, you will see, and I'll tell you very briefly, in Haiti, when you're on the ground and you're on the ground quickly, to be able to have that satellite phone and call three people who run the medical supplies and say that I need 1,000 pounds of IV fluid, or I need a certain antibiotic, or I need orthopedic equipment. Today it can get there within 24 hours. But be thinking it, because when you're on the ground, these supply chains, especially the cold supply chains like things for tetanus toxoid and that sort of thing, they don't really exist unless you're down there creating it. And I'll come back to that a little bit. Katrina, I mentioned Tuesday night, I'll never forget, because I was just like all of you watching TV. And I had access to a plane to where I could get in, and so got in. There, in that third or fourth bullet, you said about 1,800 people died. It was the most costly natural disaster in the history of the United States. The reconstruction part, I'm not going to talk about tonight, but there are a lot of parallels in terms of what you do a year later, what we're going to have to be doing a year later in terms of Haiti, in terms of infrastructure, economic development, relocation possibly, which in New Orleans it's almost impossible to do for historical reasons, but what about Port-au-Prince as we think through that? And this I took from a helicopter as well as we were coming in. Some guys from Knoxville had their helicopters down there from some of the you know police that were put their private helicopters down there. And so we spent a lot of time, but that's what you saw. This was probably September 3rd. This is probably 4 days out. Yeah, this is 4 days out. So you can still see the water still there. Bridges, you know, obviously underwater there. So people drowned. And this was out on that overpass that they'd always show on television, that you just go out, you would park, we put a temporary station up, people would come, and then we'd take them in to the airport, or they'd take them into the airport. The airport itself, this is what it looked like. This was probably Saturday, and this was the day where probably about 2,000 to 3,000 people came in. Not surgical injury. This would be primarily what I would do, and it would basically be go to a stretchers that would just fill. Every time I go in that airport today, I think I put a picture in of what the airport looks like today. This filled and lined up with stretchers there, but no surgical disease. No surgical disease at that point. Yeah, this is a good picture there. This is, I think, outside gate 19 there, if you're ever going through the airport. And it's just lined up person after person. Again, not the surgical disease. And so primarily what you were doing, unless there was some sort of heart attack, and there were a few of those, there wasn't the sort of sense of urgency of responding other than for medicines. If you're diabetic or chronic, had chronic disease, you needed to respond. And then all of a sudden, we go to Haiti. And it was 4:53, and again, when I was at home, there's no reason for me to go down to Haiti at all. I can't add anything, you know, everybody wants to do something. The worst thing we can all do is just go down. You've got to be part of a group. You've got to have had some exposure of a group. Otherwise, what will happen is that you'll go down, and when I got off the airplane, sort of 4 days after or something like that, people recognized me because I had a Samaritan's Purse shirt on and a hat, and somebody, you know, basically said Samaritan's Purse. They kind of know what they're doing on the ground. They said it was Dr. Frist. And 14 doctors came up to me from different, who'd been camping out there. And the UN had told them, don't leave, it's too dangerous. There are a lot of crowds, many of you were there outside the airport, mainly they were looking for jobs, but these doctors had just been camping there because they'd gone down there, maybe with a nurse, maybe with some supplies, but they were there by themselves. And the bottleneck at the airport made it all worse. And the only lesson to learn is don't go in unless you actually are part of a group who does have people on the ground who can get you where you're going. You can go in with a team if you've done that sort of thing before and just go set up your own facility. But if you haven't done it before, it's tough to do. You have to carry everything on your back. This is the fifth deadliest earthquake of all time. And all of you know, and many of you were down there at the time, about 5 days after it happened, the ground started shaking once again. Maybe it was 6 days after it happened, 7 days. And the panic on people's faces, it was an aftershock, but it was an aftershock that was a pretty big, another earthquake. The panic, because everybody came back to those early feelings of the buildings coming down, crushing. So the difference between what you see at Katrina and what we saw in Sri Lanka is this. This is just because I was down with Samaritan's Purse. Samaritan's Purse does international relief and has a group called World Medical Mission. It's faith-based in terms of just bringing people together. It's not sort of a lot of proselytizing on the ground, but it's a great group of people. And many of you know them, Franklin Graham and Dick Furman, and that's Dick on the left there. And Dick and I have probably done 15 trips to Africa together. He's a surgeon out of Boone, North Carolina, just a great guy. I circle these because have a group that you have worked with in the past. Flying in, this is what you saw. All of a sudden, this is a little bit different than seeing the beach itself. With the destruction there, terrible destruction there, terrible loss of life. But you see, as far as you can see, and this is in taking at Port-au-Prince, The injury itself, I think this captures it pretty well. All of you know that there's no steel used. So the buildings come down, but it's not like these little tiles coming down. That would have been concrete up above you, the way these houses are laid out. Rocks are stacked on themselves. So as soon as there is any sort of unearthing, everything caves in. And when it caves in, these big concrete slabs, which you can see here, this you can see the arm there, but it's all crush injury with legs trapped underneath. People surviving, heart's okay, lungs are okay for the most part. Usually the injuries would come where you could, if something is falling, you protect your head, you protect your vital organs. But what happens in the most common fracture is sort of bilateral tib-fib fractures, some upper extremity fractures, a lot of crush injury of hands where you are protected. The point is that surgical disease, if you don't treat it, you end up, especially if it's an open fracture, infection, gangrene, dying. And in those first few days, we had nothing there. You come in with a backpack, you've got some ketamine on board, and Kelly, that's all. I know anesthesia, there's more to it than that, but ketamine works well in the short term, if that's all you got. And and that's it. And you really shouldn't go in unless you can be self-sufficient. I'll come to that here shortly. Depending on where you are, I just threw in a picture just to remind me, say, when we first walked in on these early days, there are 300 people laid out. There's no triage. Everybody can make it to a field or the facility itself. And the smartest thing we did is, I'm a surgeon, and I do war zone surgery and do a lot of orthopedic surgery because that's most of what we do in Africa. But I wasn't prepared for the mass, the first day, the mass casualty just laying there with no triage going on at all. The facilities there, the hospitals were gone. There were four hospitals that were left. The hospitals were gone, but the doctors and the nurses either had died or they'd lost somebody in their family. And if they lost somebody in their family, they're not going to show up for work those first two or three or 4 days. And so there was really nobody to actually do the triaging. Orthopedic injury was 95% of what we saw in those first early days. Too early, really, for infection. Although, you know, day 7 and 8, you started seeing a lot more of that. Mainly crush injury. Again, so different than what was after Katrina, so different than what was after the tsunami itself. No supplies like this. No casting material, no crutches in these first 3 days, no Steinman pins, nothing. And that's why these amputations for the severe injuries really had to be done. No simple casting material. A lot of cardboard, if they could find it, being used with people coming in, but nothing like this. This was taken about 9 days afterwards where some supplies started coming in. Lots of other injuries as well in terms of laceration. You know, the purpose tonight over dinner is not to show all these pictures, but the 95% orthopedic and 5-10% laceration, bad abrasion, and the like. What we learned, the airport bottleneck, couldn't figure that out. Many of you who were down came through the Dominican Republic. That's a smart way of coming in. The airport was open for the first 24 hours, but then after 24 hours, a lot of chaos. Our military didn't take it over until about 4 days after that. But even after that, there was so much relief coming in that it was hard to get in. And I mentioned the medical personnel, a lot of chaos there. People didn't know where to go. Email was working pretty well, so that was good. They got that up and working early on. So chaos, the other unique thing about it, in contrasting to at least the tsunami, was that the centers of authority were all destroyed. You saw that one picture of the Capitol itself and the president who stayed hidden and all that. Probably didn't matter too much because there is the government there is so weak. But it does matter when the police station collapsed, and though I don't put the picture in there, and there were 20 policemen in the police station and they all died. You can't replace that sort of sense of order. The United Nations was, the headquarters building was in rubbles. Staff was missing. The big orphan issue came up, but they had nobody to talk to. There was just no authority there. Hotels and hospitals closed. CNN and in Port-au-Prince, there was one hotel there that stayed open through it all. But other than that, all civil authority, civil life just disappeared. If you had a little grocery shop, you closed it down. if you had a big grocery shop, it had already collapsed. There was no way you could open it up. The bullet that I have at the bottom is an important one, and you'll see, I'll continue to make mention of the military. The university, there are four hospitals really there. There's kind of a fifth, and then there's some scattered around. Partners was up north, and they started moving in and helping staff the hospitals that were there. University hospital there is one you saw on TV all the time. The big issue there was the chaos where everybody would just start coming in, and so there was nobody to keep people outside and put any kind of cordoning effect off, and so everybody just started coming in. It was the military that finally came in, our military, who came in and with their authority basically said, okay, here's a perimeter, stay outside the perimeter, start having some kind of identification again, get in and give some order to that. I was at Baptist Haiti Hospital, which is about 17 miles outside of Port-au-Prince, and it was the same sort of thing, although because it was a little bit further out, we didn't have quite the problems with people just coming in and demanding services and pulling physicians away and nurses away from the patients themselves. So the military-civilian communication is not ideal. It's one of the things that we need to work on. There's an article in the New England Journal of Medicine that talked a little bit about it that Paul Arbach and others wrote, and some of you may have been on that article as well. The communication where we were, the military would come in. These guys were out of Fort Bragg. They were great. And they come in, and then all of a sudden, that was good, but then all of a sudden, they would bring patients in, you know, not the truckload, but by the ambulance full, and you could fit about eight people in one of their big ambulances, but we had no supplies. And so we said, bring as many as you want. You can start helicoptering them in, but bring us supplies, too, because they had supplies back in Port-au-Prince. And then they recognized me, and, you know, they started paying a little more attention, former majority leader sitting there. And the guy, the Haitian who ran the hospital said, I don't believe the military is going to bring supplies in. And I said, this is America. These are Americans. These are the best of the best. They'll have these supplies here tomorrow. And unfortunately, they didn't have supplies there the next day. And this Haitian said, you know, you're just like everybody else. You're gullible. You're naive and all that. But it bothered me. And then at University Hospital, where they were basically taking it really depended on the military to really helicopter out the patients there to get them out to comfort the ship that was out there. And again, a lot of miscommunication. So it's one of the areas that we need to do some work. But again, having the military there, their authority, their supplies, their command, their top-down command was really fantastic. Doug Holly, who's medical director of Tennessee Task Force 1, really puts this sort of warning, if not trained, you become a liability. And that's, you know, that's something that all of you know. It's something we need to keep reinforcing because there'll be another big catastrophe here in the next 2 months. Physicians don't realize they absolutely have to be a completely self-contained resource from every aspect for what is they plan on doing. And I think that's absolutely right. You become a liability. If people have to feed you, you become a liability. If people have to give you water, you become a liability. If you can't operate in the surroundings where you can use fishing line and a little bit of ketamine in order to do pretty big operations, you become a liability. And he goes on to say, that means someone I can drop in right here and don't have to worry about them. They have all the supplies they need, their own food, water, shower, and generator, and a way to resupply themselves. Not an overstatement. That's where you have to start. Obviously, if you know you're part of a team coming in, but start with that. And literally, when I went down, even though I went down with a team of eight other people, I had a backpack, I had a small tent, not knowing what the supplies were going to be like, had a sleeping bag, and I had enough water for 3 days, enough food for 4 days, mainly candy bars. And that's the mentality you have to, I believe, start with if you're going to go in these first day or 2 days or 3 days. After that, things tend to settle down. These are a couple of the doctors who were in with us. For all their good intention, doctors who are not trained to work within disaster response structures become a reality. Both of these doctors had responded to disaster before, and they'd also been on medical missions of some sort, at least a month at a time, predominantly in Africa, but also in the Middle East. Great people. These guys hadn't worked together. I'd never met them before, but very, very good. I was talking to Kathleen and Kelly beforehand, and I think we have a role to play, all of us in the room, as we focus on surgical disease, anesthesia, nursing, surrounding it, to start standardizing what requirements should be, what the baseline should be. The 15 hours of training that you can use for, 12 hours of training that you can get for CME from the Medical Society for State of New York does teach doctors, and it's kind of superficial, but it's easy to do, and they've gotten it fairly user-friendly, but how to work with FEMA's National Incident Management System. And it does look at the terminology and systemology and these respective roles within disaster response. It's fairly elementary, but if you haven't done it, I encourage all of you to do it. You get your CME for it. And there are lots of different society-directed response curricula that are pretty good, but I think now is the time to start standardizing that going forward, because too many people, when these natural disasters occur, want to volunteer, and now with transportation, you can kind of get there. It used to be, it'd be so hard to get to these places. Now you can get to just about anywhere. Obviously, Haiti was very easy to get to because it was so close. That we need to have some sort of credentialing that's a little bit more standardized in the future. For sponsoring organizations, I mentioned Samaritan's Purse. There are lots of different organizations, and everybody works with a different organization. But go through the vetting process, not the day after the disaster. It's too late. Go ahead and encourage people to get identified with somebody, meet their credentialing bar in advance. The whole DMAT teams, the disaster medical assist teams, Tennessee Task Force 1, USB team, individual states have their DMAT teams. I think they're very, very, very good. I saw and worked side by side with them in Katrina, where both in the convention center but also in the airport on that Friday, Saturday, Sunday, they were up and running. And in the corridor of that airport down there, basically had their tent set up. Very efficient, had worked together before. This was September 4th. This was from the DMAT team, I've forgotten from where, in the airport. Again, professional time going through. So I think that's actually a great way for people to participate. So when they come and talk to me, they say they're interested, I encourage them to go in that direction. Other ways to participate, clearly, when people come up and say, you know, what can I do? You know, part of it is just being supportive. Many of you are in practices or group practices or residents or part of a hospital, employed by a hospital. But many of you are in where 80% of physicians practice today, and that is in two or three person group practices, small groups. And the person who covers for you while you're gone is probably doing just as much as you. And I think we ought to encourage that more, to develop this culture of understanding for volunteer effort. And do it in advance, not at the time, but basically say, listen, if there's a natural catastrophe, our group is going to let one of us go the next day, and we're just going to all have to step in. Very few people have that discussion in advance, but I encourage them to do that. Liability, and don't forget the text. I just threw the slide in because I worked it in Washington. But state by state, the liability for a natural disaster or a man-made disaster, state by state, is very uneven for something that occurs in this country. You can understand it overseas. It's hard to legislate something. You have to do that on sort of an individual basis because it's impossible to get licensed in Haiti in order to respond. The UN tries to you know, post a list, says we don't want doctors practicing at all unless you're on this list. And I basically said, too many people are dying over here, forget this stuff. But in country, so I would encourage you to work with your individual states, see what sort of liability provisions. We're very progressive here in Tennessee, and again, I encourage, and there are criteria, and that's what I lay out here in terms of if there is a natural catastrophe, you can respond and you will be covered. But Tennessee is one of the more progressive states. Most states really have not addressed that. As I mentioned, in Haiti, just going back for a second, poor functioning hospitals, a lot of this sort of sense of time and place you have to be flexible with. A lot of the initial care was in fields, in parks, going through these camps. Basically, these camps are not camps. They're basically just tents thrown up or tarps thrown up. You see them on TV. And identifying people who have these crush injuries that would just be lying there. And so you'd have to spend about, depending on if you had people to do it, but an hour a day just going through to identify people. And there the easiest thing to do is to triage them to some corner of the field itself. Simple surgeries performed. If you can perform any of the surgery on site, you want to perform it on site. This is, in the first week of these natural disasters. Use empty spaces, use fields, use parks, use schools. We used orphanages as well. I add on here, water is critical. And one of the first things that Samaritan's Purse did was send in a water supply system for where we were going to be. These water supply systems that they make today, one or two are solar powered. I don't know if they really work solar powered. But so you have to take a generator in. They'll produce about 10,000 gallons of water a day, which is a lot of water. And that's enough to take care of a pretty good sized clinic, hospital, and also, if you can do it, to take care of the community outside. And if it happens to be a sort of refugee camp, if depending on what part of the world you're in, or it happens to be a village, it's a huge advantage in terms of building goodwill when you're coming into an area if you can supply the water. The machines themselves are about from here to the end of that, maybe from here to the end of this black sort of rope line here and that square, and little generators can run it. But I encourage you to pay attention to that, because over a 2 or 3 week period, you run out of water and you run out of clean water. And then obviously for basic health care, you are in trouble. So whatever group you work with, come back, start with water, have them get clean water in. Just a couple of other things. Jenny runs Hope Through Healing Hands, which is really just a foundation we run here in Tennessee, that we have a global leadership program where we send right now about 14 nurses, doctors, medical students around the world. We work with the corporate world to have the corporate people who may have nothing to do with healthcare, send them out to work with hospitals and clinics for infrastructure, for accounting, for patient flow. So we're a small foundation, but a little foundation like us, with me going on the ground, with being able to pick up the phone and in just some pictures that I showed you, when I got down, all of a sudden we were amputating everything, really getting on the phone and getting back and talking to Synthes, who makes orthopedic equipment, basically say, these are the six things we need. These orthopedic companies have all sorts of stuff, but they have no idea how to get it there. Or for them to say, we'll provide as much as you can in the next 8 to 12 hours, and then to be able to get equipment in within 3 days that stopped us having to do amputations, is what I think the system should do. It's also the advantage of having this continuous flow and supply chain of people on the ground. I mention that because if you're just a regular old doctor and you're on the ground and you see something, have channels set up or people to call back in the States or a foundation like we are, but have that in advance to be able to pick up the phone and say, these are the six things I need. You know, I need 25 cases of Ringer's lactate, otherwise I'm getting killed. I need antibiotics. We're 7 or 8 days afterwards. We've drained everything we can. Now we just need antibiotics, and these are the antibiotics we need. Get those chains set up. IV fluids, you'll see some pictures of me. When I decided to go, I went to a local hospital here and said, I want your IV fluid. I want 500 pounds I'll take with me. I didn't know how to get it there, and I'll show you a picture here. I just went out to Delta Airlines and said, I got 500 pounds IV fluid. I'm going to Haiti. Got a backpack. Help me. Now, you'd think the former Majority Leader of the United States Senate would have connections and be able to work it, but you don't. But that's what this business is all about, and it takes that sort of ingenuity, and luckily I found some nice lady who's now trying to get a promotion somewhere else. I'm going to get her a promotion. I said, she's the best coming in. Orthopedic supplies, IV fluids, fuel for helicopters. About a week later, we heard about these helicopters on the ground. I saw them taking patients. And then these guys called me because they knew who we were. And we were down there working with them. They said, we got the helicopters. We got the manpower. We got the pilots. We got the volunteers. But we got no fuel. And we're down there, and we got no money. We got no cash to buy the fuel. And so by working very directly, very quickly, within 24 hours, we had the helicopters up and running. This sort of vertical line of communication is absolutely critical. So it's really more than sitting down there, doing abdominal surgery or doing surgery. Just be thinking innovatively and creatively as you go through. A sterilizer, did I put the sterilizer? Yeah, there's the sterilizer right there. Again, the sort of autoclave, simple sterilizer, how do you get it there? What do you need? Basically, little small foundations who are set up to do it. There can be a lot of abuse there, but identify those foundations that you know you can work with in advance as well. Ours is Hope Through Healing Hands. I mentioned that we're using the whole mantra of currency for peace. which I believe in. I know it. I see it. I saw it in southern Sudan most directly at a hospital I'd go to every year for 10 years. When we went in, the fighting stopped. The landmines were removed. The hospital opened back up. It is a currency for peace. I say the same thing to President Obama, to President Bush. The sort of might and the power that we show through our military force in Afghanistan, Iraq, critically important. It really is the might of America, but at the same time, this softer side of using medicine, health, and I would add education, is a real currency for peace. A lot of relief organizations, don't even, you know, I just listed some of them up there. There are lots of good, I think, and this is where Kathleen does a great job, and I think using the website at the American College of Surgeons, and I think all of us can do a better job in terms of communication, of having trusted sites we can go to, that you can identify, that we can stand behind, that we can brand. There's nobody that does that very well. Therefore, most of the money today goes to the American Red Cross, a great organization, but very different than the sort of stuff that we're talking about right now. Very different, and I love the American Red Cross. But if you look at where corporate money goes today, it basically goes to big entities and Save the Children that I'm on the board of. We have $50 million. And now we still have, and we have 200 people on the ground working hard, but we got $40 million that we can't spend. And what we need to be able to do is identify organizations who are on the ground, whether it's in the recovery, or the response phase, or the recovery phase, or rehabilitation phase, and support them and list them. So the only reason I list that up there, because I think we have a real role to play in terms of branding as we think over the next 3 days. This is the woman who, so literally, there's my backpack going, and there were eight of us that had to meet in Palm Beach, and on a Sunday morning, or whatever morning it was, I couldn't find anybody, and I had 500 pounds of fluid. But my bag outside, 66 pounds, cost me $50. No, 16 pounds cost me $50, and I had 500 pounds. So I started, oh, gosh, what am I going to do? But this woman, nice woman, basically said, she ran the cargo, just come on out. Basically loaded up the IV fluid myself on that morning. That's sort of one picture. I'll come back to it. It takes a team to do all this stuff, obviously. Kind of like, you know, running the heart and lung transplant program. Everybody says, oh, you're running the heart and lung transplant program. In truth, you're just sewing these organs in. But it takes the anesthesiologist, and it takes the person drawing the blood, and the perfusionist, and the person doing the helicopter, and the person answering the phone, coordinate, and the organ procurement agency. This is the same thing. So I throw a few of these pictures in, and you'll see some of these in a few minutes. But these are the two nurses. I talked about the 400 people, 300 people in a room like this lying down. These nurses, basically, who we took down, one from Hopkins, one from North Carolina, basically said, go away, Dr. Frist. I said, what do you mean? They said, go away. Come back in 3 hours. Literally came back in 3 hours, and the people who were going to die were over here. The people who had open wounds, the people who had dirty wounds over here, the people who needed immediate surgery here. And then all of a sudden, I relaxed, and the other surgeons relaxed. And so it really does take a team that is sort of multifactorial in terms of teaching, in terms of thinking, and these women were unbelievable in terms of what they were able to do. I throw this picture in only because the Haitians who were there, who after about 3 to 4 days would start coming back to work, were obviously critical. I don't speak Creole, and if you're just sitting there fixing a wound, you don't need to speak it, but you got to go talk to the family. You need to talk to the family for the rehab and all. And so this establishing a relationship, if you already have it on the ground, it's good. In Haiti, none of us had it. A lot of churches do work there. There's not a lot of affiliation with hospitals in advance, but these relationships absolutely critical. This is a young girl, and I throw this in because a typical sort of injury. She's a 16-year-old girl. She went to school at about 4 o'clock to pick up some work. Thank goodness this didn't happen during school. It happened about 4:50, 4:53 in the afternoon. But she went to pick up some schoolwork. While she was in the schoolroom, the buildings collapsed on her. This is her dad. Her dad knew she'd gone to school, but he went to the school grounds, and this is about 15 miles from Port-au-Prince, and went to the school grounds, and there were 6 buildings, but all were collapsed. But he knew his daughter was in one of these collapsed buildings. Concrete, huge buildings collapsed, rubble up probably 15 feet. And so this is 4:53, got to be dark at 6 o'clock. He went back and got flashlights at 7 o'clock. At 8 o'clock, he'd go from mound to mound just yelling out for his daughter. There were about 12 people who had died there who were in the buildings, and he couldn't find her. Then about 10 o'clock at night, he got to the fifth mound, and he called out her name, and to say it was Denise, I forgot, it was Denise. And then from the bottom of the rubble, down about 12 feet, he heard a little voice, Daddy, Daddy. So this was 8 hours after the injury, and he looked down, and he saw just her back. It was concrete all around, saw just her back. So he couldn't see her face, but he saw her shirt or whatever she had on. And then he said, I'll be back. And he went back and got his son. He got a pick, because there are no supplies, there are no bulldozers and that sort of thing. And he started chipping away. And he chipped away for the first 8 hours, the first 24 hours, the first 30 hours, the first 60 hours. And it took him 2.5 days, upright, almost 3 days to get her out. Couldn't feed her down there, but they just kept this conversation going. So on rounds that next morning, in Creole, it's a Bible. And it was really kind of, no matter who you are, really kind of overwhelming, because he had some verse in there where shepherd calling out and hearing to his sheep and responding. So it was really kind of a great experience. You can see how happy they are now. Did on her arm and her leg, did fasciotomy, so I'm not sure what's going to happen right now. She had no, or when we left, she had no sensation and no function there, but again, alive and got good medical care. So I'm going to take just three more minutes, and some of the stories that I mentioned to you, I'll introduce you to, and then I will close with that.
What if I were that mother staring from my TV? What if that were my brown-eyed baby, hungry as she could be? What if that were my family? What if that was my world? Waiting on water, waiting on a vaccine, waiting on someone to bring me a bag of beans. Lord, have mercy on me.
I just went over to the hospital and asked them for this, and they basically said they loaded up.
Waiting on me. Big success, so well dressed on the
earth. Let me see, I'll get it back here. The plane that you saw there, the large corporate plane that you saw there, was donated by, I'm going to display this until we get up to it, was donated by a private foundation, and that private foundation, I don't know who they are to this day, but they ran that plane back every two to three trips a day. And so some faceless foundation running this in with supplies each and every day.
What if that was my world? Waiting on water, waiting on a vaccine, waiting on someone to bring me a bag of beans. Lord, have mercy on me. Could be mother, could be
when he called for her. She answered. Then it took them 3 days to get everything off, to get her free. I couldn't feed her. She couldn't drink or eat because her head is pink.
No.
She sat down. Finally got her out.
I show that. Let me turn the lights up. Those are just pictures that I sort of took, you know, with my camera going through. And all of you have many, many experiences, and in this room has more expertise than has probably ever been gathered in terms of focusing on surgical disease. I think we have a huge opportunity, to, yes, take crises, and the crisis has occurred, but to take crises and really analyze them systematically to see how we can improve that structure, the algorithms, the infrastructure to make sure that we respond to that next crisis in a way that's more sophisticated, more mature, and ultimately has even a better outcome. Those things don't just happen, and it takes a body of 300 people who are interested, who the older people like me who are at it for a little bit longer can at least share experiences with the people who are, Ali, who had us met, people like you who are in residency program, who can really take this to that next level. Capture what this generation does have, an ability to travel, an ability to move, an ability to capture science and apply it in ways that has never been applied before. People ask me, why in the world I involved with this and so far away, and it really is that excitement of hope, that excitement of dreams, which can become a reality today, which 30 years ago just couldn't happen. 20 years ago it couldn't happen. 10 years ago it couldn't happen. But today it's within our grasp. So to do what all of you have done and participated in over the last couple of years, and that is to establish that body of surgical knowledge with anesthesia tied in, with nursing tied in, with surgical disease, with defining that. And then now what really is the challenge over the next 3 days, and that is to go using this little mantra from science, which we got that body of information we need to contribute to advocacy, to get out and share that information, to link it to public health, to link it to what I'll be doing with President Clinton and President Bush, part of this Haiti fund, this Clinton-Bush Haiti fund, to basically have surgical disease be a focus of that fund. Now we can do that because we have that sort of information. So I'm delighted to be with you. It's a great opportunity for me to be here. I'm your partner in this as we go forward. I am glad that all of you, either directly or indirectly, have met Jenny tonight. And with that, working with Meharry, who has been a great leader in this field in global health, and working with Vanderbilt, and working with the School of Nursing, and working with all of you, I'm convinced we can help change the course of humanity. Thank you. Y'all have a great night. Appreciate it.
Well, the senator has time for a few questions if anyone in the audience would like to ask him a question about any of his experiences.
Or give advice, you know, in terms of what you think we should be doing. The one thing that I have, that some of you in the room have, but only because I happen to have spent the time there, is access to Washington, D.C. And I'll be going to Washington tomorrow morning, and it's fun for me to be able to share information, what we've learned, with people who are deciding policy, making policy. And so I want to extend that invitation to you as well, if there are things that we can change in terms of licensing standards.